Good morning from Maui. My name is Eric, and I'm here to share some movement principles. It's a meditation in motion. It's also the essence of Tai Chi principles all incorporated in one single unified movement. It makes it a very powerful thing to practice, and this is something that anybody can practice anywhere. You need no special equipment or anything other than about this much space. We're going to do this in a standing posture. Whether you're watching this in sitting or standing, just listen, internalize it, and practice. This video is not meant to be a complete guidance in this to follow. It's meant to speak the principles so that you can feel them inside and then practice this on your own. We will begin with standing in the standing posture, and every posture of stillness is rooted in balance. Balance is rooted in the feet and the legs, upper body sitting upon them. In standing, we want to be able to connect internally in the body, and the best way to connect internally in the body is to allow your eyes to go soft. Feel inside. It's not looking at your body from the outside, it is feeling into the sensational qualities of just being. We connect with breathing. We will focus the tension of breathing around the belly. The belly in the in-breath, you feel the quality of awakening, arising on the in-breath, and feel the qualities of releasing, of grounding on the out-breath. This will be something to check into all during your time of practice in standing. As we give the weight of the upper body to the legs, notice that the knees really should never be straight back. They need to be slightly bent. They can be more bent if that's comfortable for you, but it's not important. It's important that they are just slightly bent and the legs are receiving the weight of the body. This will allow your breathing and the sense of quality of breathing in your belly to be freer. We also want, in the breathing, we notice the awakening quality of the in-breath, and we're usually focused more on the front of the belly. We also are benefited if we can feel the quality of opening in the lower back as well. When the abdomen opens for the in-breath, it opens front and back. When the back is allowed to open, it allows the tailbone to relax down. We want the tailbone to be almost have the quality of a weight hanging from it, pulling down. But we don't want to be pushing it down. It's a releasing. Balance comes from releasing, not making something happen. At the same time that the tailbone is relaxing down, there's a quality of suspension from the back of the head, from the head top, so that it's not a compression sinking, it's actually an extension of suspending the head top, sinking the tailbone, allowing the legs to carry the weight. Feeling into the feet, where the body is making contact with the earth, the floor, whatever. We want to feel the whole bottom of the foot making contact. If you feel more pressure on the instep or the outstep, it means your knees are not over your toes. Good to get a little sensation of what it means for the legs to be fluid and be able to sink into the foot. And at the same time, the bottom of the foot is maintaining firm contact with the ground. The bottom of the foot has two arches in it, one forward back, one side to side. The weight of the body is meant to go right where these two arches cross. So there will not be, in a standing posture, more pressure on the heel or the toe, or the inside or the outside, but right through a very flat, firm footprint of sensation in the feet. Feeling the breathing. We can exaggerate just a little bit the quality of inhalation and rising, exhalation, sinking. The weight of the body is evenly distributed, left and right. Just a slight quality of rising on the in-breath and sinking on the out-breath. Now, if the arms here are just hanging, they are not going to be doing anything, eventually in the cycling motion that we will get into, the arms can be included in this. They can be included by raising and lowering. We're not going to do much with them. The raising of the arm, the important thing is that it is being raised with the body raising it, and minimum effort in the shoulders and anywhere else in the body. So that is what it looks like when your shoulder is raising your arm. When it's raised naturally, it's almost as if there's a weight hanging from your elbow and a string, like a puppet string, from your wrist. This will help the hands be soft. When the hands are soft, they will form a natural curve here called tiger's mouth sometimes, open jaw. That's just the quality of an empty hand. It's not doing this, it is the non-doing of this. We're finding what is in the body in its natural state. What we will encounter are places of holding and tension in the body. We will encounter these for the rest of our lives because the body just has these habitual places of holding. And so we can still be raising the arm with the shoulder and then feel that. So these principles are to help bring awareness to our daily life activity and how we can be more, have more integrity in our body as we are living our life in it. The hands can raise in front, and for this purpose we'll only be raising them about at shoulder height. It's not about getting extension, it's about maintaining emptiness. Later we'll see also ways that we can play with the cycling motion with the arms raised to the side. This may sound really simplistic, but as all the principles come together, you'll notice that there's a reason for this. We're bringing everything in motion down to a single non-doing of movement that is arising in the legs are directing the waist is directing the upper body is directing the arms. The head goes along for the ride. As we get into the cycling part, the eyes are going to be panning side to side. I'm going to have to be doing this for the purpose of the video with my eyes front, but I will be explaining about the panning. We're just going to allow that to happen in its own way. So principle one, balance. Solid on the feet, allowing the legs to carry the weight. The hips are being carried by the legs. Tailbone relaxed down, head top suspended up, arms simply hanging to the side. The motions that we can do from here are, one would be sinking and raising. Sinking and raising. That's one type of motion. The other kind of motion we can do from here is turning the waist. In order to turn the waist, we have to use the hips. One hip always needs to close and the other hip always needs to open. That's the only way it's going to happen with integrity. If we don't do that, then we are pulling the leg around. We are losing our root to the ground. To keep the foot flat and keep the legs carrying the weight in the proper way, this hip has to open while this one collapses. And turning the waist to the other side, this hip opens, this hip collapses. That's all it is. But what you'll encounter perhaps is a lot of unconscious holding in here that wants to just drag everything along with it. That's why we're doing the exercise, is to expose places where we're unconscious in our bodily movement and posture. This is a journey of finding out all the bad news, while at the same time we are awakening conscious awareness in the body and releasing stress that we're holding unconsciously in the body. So we can sink, we can rise, we can turn the waist side to side. This isn't an extreme turn. The navel will only be point turning about that far. That's as far as it needs to go. We're more interested in the opening, in the sensations, than we are in extension of movement in this. The other basic principle entails shifting the weight. In this posture, the spine is right centered between the 2 feet. The 2 feet can be anywhere from shoulder width apart to a little wider, a little narrower, whatever is comfortable. There's not a better or worse, but as we get into this, I'll show you the difference that is entailed in that. In shifting the weight, we do this on a sinking. Sinking into one side means that the weight is being carried more on this leg than on this leg. This leg is still carrying its own weight. We're not going over. We're staying grounded. Sinking into one side, rising, sinking into the other side. It's actually a very small movement. If we notice that centered, the weight is here, it's only going to go this far. So this is all about containment, not about extension. It will allow for extension in the long run. For now, we're keeping the navel, the waist, pointing forward. It's just shifting the weight, sinking on one side, sinking on the other side. When we put these principles together into a cycling motion, what we're going to have is the arms are still hanging, but as we turn the waist, they're flung out. In their own natural way. The arms are not moving the waist, the legs are moving the waist. The arms and shoulders are following the waist. As we cycle, notice there doesn't have to be any particular form to it, but in this, we see that there are 4 ways to cycle. When our weight is on one side, we can cycle the waist outward from that or inward from that. Just 2 ways. Cycling out, cycling in, cycling out, cycling in, and there's no shift in the weight. In order for this cycling to happen properly, the knee is not turning side to side because that's going to take the weight off of the center of the foot. The knees are going more over the toe and back a bit, over the toe, back a bit. That's the integrity of the joints. That's what they were designed to move. There may be slight movement in there. But notice when you're on one side, you can cycle out, cycle in. Just internalize that to feel the difference. On the other side, cycling out, cycling in. Now shifting the weight, you can cycle out, 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 in, out, in. Make it up as you go along. There's no need to do it any particular way. Ultimately, as you really feel these different principles, there are many, many ways of expanding this into your own movements. But this will ground the energy, it'll ground the attention in the body into where it needs to be for any kind of swinging, any kind of lifting, any kind of needing of power of the body is still needs to come from here. And that's part of what these principles are used for. In the old Tai Chi classics, there is the image of what's known as the Dharuma doll, which in my childhood transformed into Bozo the Clown punching bag. If you, for those who recall, it's like a balloon and the sand is on the bottom. You touch the top, it bounces right back because it's empty on top, it's weighted in the bottom. This principle of being weighted in the bottom and empty up top goes thousands of years back in martial arts history. When you feel that in the body, you realize how much tension can be held in the chest, up in the shoulders, because from here we are doing life. And every moment of unconsciousness in our doing adds more tension in our doing. So regard this exercise as a non-doing. The Chinese is wei wu wei, doing non-doing. All that's happening in any of this right here is balance on the feet, shifting the weight, cycling the waist, and being conscious if it's in or out, if it's rising, falling. These are all internal. It's not that they have to be demonstrated as falling and sinking and rising. It's just to feel that in the inside that this is going on. Outside is very disguised. One can do an exercise of cycling like this in an airport, and you can be doing everything that's incorporated in a Tai Chi dance, but you don't have to be doing Tai Chi in the airport and attracting attention to yourself. You can just be cycling, and hopefully everybody else will see how good that is for relieving the stress of sitting in little seats, dealing with masses of people. Empty the mind, be conscious in the body. Now there's one more principle to add to what we're doing. I'm exaggerating a little bit here just for the demonstration purposes. You can be doing this with your feet closer together. And again, the legs, moving the waist. If you're in balance, you're not going to be thrown off. The waist moves the shoulders. The shoulders move the arms. the last of the really core principles here is called cross-substantiality. And what it's referring to is the body's way of directing its efforts from one leg out through the other arm. If your right leg is strong and carrying the weight, it's your left arm that's going to be strong in balance. If this arm were strong, you would be out of balance and leaning. If this arm is strong, that allows you to, it balances that motion. You will find this in almost any sport, that if you want power through your right arm, it's going to come from your left. If you want power in your left, it's going to come from your right. And so these aren't principles that are foreign to us. It's ones that we just may not have thought of in these terms. And the importance of understanding principles is that they become applicable to many, many things in life. The same power of the swinging will be the power of a tennis racket stroke, or a golf swing, or most anything you can conceive of, even pushing open a stuck door. If you're pushing with your right arm, try to push off of your left, and then you won't damage your body. When you're doing it this way, it's sending energy cross, and the cross is right behind the navel, right below the navel, and you may have noticed that this is where a lot of people have problems in their body, and it's not for no reason that where our energies cross is where they get jammed up if that part is held tight. Most holding in the lower back is going to come from the tailbone being contracted up. And so this motion is turning the waist down, not pushing it down, allowing it to sink down. That would be the principle of emptiness. So when you're cycling, you can feel this is where it gets more complex, and it's not to think about it it's to feel it within the body, that as I'm cycling onto the left leg, it's the right arm and shoulder that's going to kind of like feel the balance to that. And on this side, it's going to be the other arm that's balancing to that. That keeps this whole motion into a single unified movement with integrity. Now, referring back to something I mentioned earlier, if your eyes are soft, then your head is just following your navel and your gaze is sweeping across. You're not looking at anything. You're letting your eyes go soft, release within. That helps bring your focus of attention to the present, not into whatever you're thinking about. It enables you to feel into your body more clearly. However, if in fact you are watching this video while you're doing this, or you're doing this as an exercise and you're watching television or something like that, and you keep your eyes focused on a point, then notice at that point you're releasing the neck so that your eyes stay still, and then you have your shoulders swinging under your chin. This is breaking the rule minimally, but if you're conscious of it, there's not a problem with that. So, incorporating everything that we've done so far, we can have balance in the body, balanced, grounded through the feet, weight carried in the legs carry and direct the waist, the shoulders follow the waist, arms are just hanging, but now we're going to bring them into motion, raising one arm and letting it drop, and raising the other arm, letting it drop. Keep the wrist soft, tiger's mouth, wrist soft, weight under the elbow. Whether you're opening a jar, trying to do some strength in front of you, this is where you're going to find the strength from here to work your hands if they're more empty. And so we are working with emptiness and substantiality. That's what cross substantiality is. Half of the body is going to be substantial, the other half is going to be empty. This cross is substantial, this side is empty. When we incorporate raising the hands and turning the waist, the waist turn is going to move the hand. But what we're doing is moving the hand up and moving it down. The waist is turning it from side to side. So what will happen is a circle will begin to form. Whether you're cycling on one side or the other, the hands are doing very little except raising and lowering. What this does is forces your attention more into the whole body, all four extremities, and it's going to require that the mind just go more consciously quiet within in order to do this. This is often very difficult at first, as simple as it actually is. At first it can be very difficult because we're asking our attention to be in more parts of the body than we tend to normally be. And that's why it will feel awkward at first. If it does feel awkward, that's a good reason for continuing, not a good reason for stopping. If we increase the speed of this, the arms are going to, by their own inertia, are going to be a little bit more extended. But again, basically, we are only shifting the weight, turning the waist, raising and lowering the hands. Not much else is happening. This is something to feel into. To embrace a more kinesthetic sense of what's going on in the body as I am moving it. It's bringing it into conscious awareness, what I'm actually doing in and about my own body. And part of it is going to reveal a lot of, I never felt that part of my body before. We didn't do anything. We just awakened to it. I'm just going to demonstrate a few different ways of extending these principles into other kinds of movement, but they're all coming from exactly the same thing. My recommendation is that feel this out and create whatever movement you want within yourself. But when you check into the principles, it can tell you whether what you're doing is in integrity or not really in integrity. Whenever we're leaning, we've lost integrity in the body because one side is going to be really tense in order to hold, keep you from falling over. If you release from here, you either fall over or you come back into integrity. There's only two ways you can go. If you're overextended, you're out of balance. Once you're out of balance, you're holding all kinds of things in order to keep from falling over. So this is about waking up inside so that we can be in balance and eventually gain more power in the arms, not through strength, but because they are moving from the legs, not from the shoulder. And so with this, and this particular video is not going to go any further than this, I'm just going to show what free swinging can become. You're cycling. If I bring more sinking into it, it'll throw the arms up. Want to release shoulder tension? This is one way to do it. You can also let the arms swing around and slap. This again helps to awaken the body. There's one way that you can play with going a little bit out of a certain kind of integrity, and that's to swing around and look at your other opposite heel. Some point, I may make another video that is taking these principles and starting from where we're leaving off here and expand from that. What I'd like to suggest is that this is the kind of an exercise like a yoga, which is about awakening mind-body connection within ourselves. It's an endless task because it has to be in the present. It has to be here and now. Here and now isn't taken care of in the past, it's taken care of in the present. So the principles are something we bring into the present, we keep them awake and alive, and the effort is not forget. Once they're embodied, we don't need to forget. If you look for applications in what your own world is, sawing wood, sweeping floors, all of these things can be embraced in those motions. In the absence of motion, sitting at a desk, you can still feel the importance of relaxed elbows, soft hands. If your elbows are like this, if you're typing or whatever, you're going to be building tension the entire time. And this is very difficult for many people because your attention is externalized to the computer or whatever, and I lose contact in the body. When the eyes are soft and they're focused, you can be in the body and dealing with what we're dealing with. That's the ultimate multitask. Be in the body and in where your attention is being externalized to. For just the practice of swinging, it's totally internalized. There's nothing outside of this motion of interest. The eyes are not looking at anything. They're just relaxing, softening inside. This helps quiet the thinking mind. Quieting the thinking mind supports awakening conscious awareness in the body. If one were to practice nothing more than this cycling, whether it's just subtly standing in line at the bank or whatever, just turning, or taking it into a little bit more, the principles are the same. If your legs are wider, your knees may be a little bit in from the toes by nature, but the movement of the knee is still over the toe and back. It's not sideways, or the integrity of your whole root to the ground is broken. This joint isn't meant to go that way. And usually where you have to let go and give up is in these joints right here. That's the region that stiffens the body in its turning ability. So I share these in good spirit. I believe that there is value in this motion. I feel there's value in this movement because it embraces so many core principles of bodily movement, whether we are walking, whether we are climbing rocks, whether we're walking upstairs. If you seek, you will find all kinds of ways to find this quality of stillness, internal stillness in the movement of the body. And as you go really still, as in standing, sitting meditation, you'll see that there's change happening in every moment of your life. It takes stillness to see the change. It takes change to find the stillness. When the two are embraced, you have clear integrity in our inner being and are better prepared to deal with the world that we have to deal with. No matter where you are, sitting, standing, walking, in line, just moseying along, if you can feel your feet, if you can feel how your legs are moving and the consciousness there, you'll notice that your mind is already closer to being present than it normally is. Anytime we can release our eyes, be in the body, we are a much bigger step to being present. There's another quantum leap to absolute consciousness, but to get there, you must go through your body, feeling the consciousness that is already embraced within us. And an exercise like this, which requires very little doing, in the beginning it may require thinking about the movement, maybe more than you feel comfortable with, but it leads to a place where you can just end the thought altogether. In the Taoist principle, this is called investment and loss. The investment and loss in the swinging, when you give up your arms to be sunk into your lower body and allow your feet, your legs to truly be carrying yourself around, you gain strength through losing substantiality up here. You gain strength in the whole system. So these principles go very, very deep. The more you look into them, the more you will wake up to the power that's inherent in embracing these things in those times of day when the mind is just wants to be busy thinking about what it's going to do or what it has just been doing. Anytime, release the eyes, be present in the present, you find your ground. When you connect that in the body, ground it in your feet, you're here. And here is not a step forward. Here is a releasing back. So, enjoy. Be well. there is a lot to incorporating all these principles at one time. I'm showing them now so that they're all in one package. My recommendation is to get very clear inside about the movements without using the arms for anything, and then start incorporating the arms as you feel comfortable in doing that without distracting from what's happening down here, because your inner attention is still rooted in your midsection here, not in your head, in your belly, and opening from here. So that when you can incorporate the movement of the arms doing their cycling, while not losing integrity with your awareness in the belly, that's going to be a good practice. But this is going to be more confusing until you're clear about shifting the weight, turning the waist, cycling the body. That is the more important thing to internalize and be clear about. Everything else that you do with your arms is going to arise from that. Another type of extended movement from this is when the arms rise to the sides and you exaggerate the sinking and the raising. And I'll show you where this can go in the movement. It's still the legs that are raising the arms. But it becomes just another way of allowing the raising and then the gravity to go from there. And this is another one where you can use the gravity for a kind of slapping, maybe a kind of tapping or pecking at parts. This is still the soft hand. And the soft hand rises, it'll be almost like it's holding a tea bag and just letting it drip. I mean, that's all the motion there is in that. Raised from the wrist, weighted from the elbow. And so, sinking, rising, sinking, rising, sinking, sinking, rising. So again, when you exaggerate the sinking, that allows the arms more freedom to come up. And as you're just free form playing with this, any movement that's coming from those principles, sinking, rising, turning the waist, and cycling out and in, that all those principles you're just allowing gravity to